First, let me tell you what handling containers is all about. Well, it's kind of self-explanatory, but our system works as follows. You see the crane obviously loading and unloading the containers to the shore and back on the ship. What is special about ECT is the automated concept. We work with robotic cars. We have a site-wide Wi-Fi network to support the cars. It's a big of a very big TomTom-alike application that's behind it. Afterwards, containers go into the automated stack for further transportation. Further transportation can mean back to a ship. It can also mean off to a truck or train. A crane team exists of a crane driver, of course, the on-ship controller, a man who is on the deck of the ship. He has the most risky part of the deal. There's someone at the quay site handling the container to the AGV and controlling customs. And there's a central dispatcher, and he's at the control tower. On the land side, of course, the straddle carrier driver, a truck driver, and also a central dispatcher. We've heard mission critical communications a lot. To us, every container move is mission critical. A container weighs for about 40 tons. The spreader that lifts the container is about 20 tons. So we like to do that about every 2 minutes average loading time. So for your imagination, a container of maximal 60 tons goes up and down in 2 minutes. And it, the distance is for about 300 or 400 meters. It has to travel. We have in peak operation a lot of crane teams are going on. Well, it's that's always a problem to handle good communications. In total, we have about 850 concurrent users in day shift, approximately 2,300 mobile users in total. Okay. Here you see what it means to have a big ship in the on the quay. Containers are stacked 16 rows, as deep as 7 rows below deck. It's quite a distance. We have to unlock the containers before we can load them, unload them. You see it's done by a gondola. It's the left side picture. People are in that gondola to open the twist locks, and you see a small picture of a gondola of a twist lock at the side. It weighs for about 1.5 kilo. You can imagine that the man in the gondola likes to have good communication with the crane driver, since he is moving up and down from between the containers. Here you see two pictures of what the man on deck sees, where he is, and what the crane driver sees. You can see the distances between those people. You can also imagine the risk that the man on the deck is in when loading and unloading containers. Also, a ship is like a jungle at sea. You don't know exactly what you find when you enter a ship. Different safety rules from ships. Because of the different safety rules, skip that. Thank you. of standard loading unloading is also risky part. With such an operation, the deckman has to have constant contact with the crane driver. The crane driver often cannot see where the load is going to. So it's also rather mission critical. A dispatcher. You see here, dispatcher has a lot of screens. Because of the automated concept we use at ECT, he has to divide his attention to a lot of ongoing processes. He must control about 12 crane teams, including the automated concept, including maintenance. So every move he has to make contact with the crane team, has to be a single click operation. Okay, now we switch to our current system. We operate now with an ADAC system from Ericsson. It was installed in 96. We have 20 line dispatchers. In the old days, it was done by a four-wire Nokia modems. It works rather well. It uses transmission trunking to eliminate bandwidth. And a special for our business is that a dispatcher controls the emergency call. We use IP67 handhelds. That is necessary because of, most pictures were taken in broad day sunlight, but handhelds have to work -1 degree centigrade, vertical rain, and mostly on Saturday night. We like the handhelds to support convert-to-collie. It means when we're both almost talking at the same time, one of the parties has to switch to listen modus. Now, the disadvantages now from our system is spare parts are hard to get. Service can only be provided via local representative from Poland and from there to the United States. So it's not the best situation for us. Here you see an example of our dispatcher application we use. It's very clinical. It's all one-click operations. No windows that switch open or so. Every operation has a direct action as a result. No waiting times. Our requirements, we did not want a Tetra system. Why should you want a Tetra system? We just want to support our container operation with a communication system. Our requirements are very clear. 23 line dispatchers. They must be fully configurable. We want transmission trunking. A dispatcher owns emergency call. You want the harbor-proof handhelds. Convert to Collie again, and spare parts and service around the corner. We also want commercially off the shelf. Well, we didn't end up with that. Let's say that. Our result, what was the result of the project? We choose SIT Zenitel for system integrator. They did a fine job in bringing us Rohil and Hytera under our attention. Rohil provided us with a tailor-made network and dispatcher solution. Hytera for robust IP57 handhelds. And a message from our sponsor. Okay. I hand over to Jan now.
I'm Jan van der Meij. I work for SIAT Zenitel, and I had the honor to work with Koen. Thank you very much for the order, Koen. And I must say, you didn't make it easy for us, but I think we can manage. This SIAT Zenitel, I don't think it's very interesting for you. Spectrum, spectrum, spectrum. Well, what you heard before is that we have a lot of cranes, a high number of cranes. The call duration is very short, and that's the reason for transmission trunking. We'll come back to that later. When we go to trunking systems in the Netherlands, we have to have 410 to 430 megahertz, and the 410 to 420 megahertz band is extremely crowded. And it's crowded with systems that have 12 half kilohertz bandwidth. If you want to have a Tetra system with 25 kilohertz bandwidth, then you have a very nice challenge. You have to offer three 25 kilohertz, 12 half kilohertz channels for one Tetra channel if you use the same offset, frequency offset of 12 and a half kilohertz. That's the reason that we went for 6.25 kilohertz offset, and especially in the start of the Tetra systems, that was not easy because there were not very many subscriber equipment available for 6.25. But we found it, and that's a good thing. If you want to have your certificate later, you have to calculate the probability of queuing. Here's the formula of it. On the left-hand side, you see Mr. Erlang. On the right top side, you see the ministry, and that's our regulator in the Netherlands for the frequencies. And the Erlang formula is a very nice one, but not valid actually for what we are doing, because it has to work with an infinite number of users. And although we have 850 users, it's a lot, but not infinite. The traffic load, we have two terminals. It's called the Delta terminal and the Euromax terminal. You've seen it before in Koen's presentation. A total of three sites, one terminal with two sites and one terminal with one site, and a total of 850 subscribers, and that's a lot. And that's for all the crane teams. And when you see the next slide, you'll see the traffic load calculation. We see a maximum of 0.23 Erlang per crane or per crane team. And a crane team is actually the four people that are on top of the list. That's the crane driver and the people on shore and the people on deck. So there's a lot of traffic on a crane team. And if you have a lot of crane teams, you also obviously have a lot of traffic. You see 7.18 Erlang for 10 cranes. And that's a measured figure. It's not calculated, but measured. And of course, when all cranes are in use, you have a lot more traffic than the 7.18 Erlang. The orange, yeah, it's also orange on screen, part is the land operation. Apart from the sea operation where the cranes are, there's also a lot of land operation. And that is also responsible for a lot of traffic on the terminals. Here you see on the Delta terminal, that's the largest of the two, what are the two parts that we have for site number one and site number two. And you can see on site number one, we have more than 9,000 calls per hour. On site number two, we have almost 5,000 calls per hour. What I actually did and what we asked to our regulator is 65% and 45%, which is 110% together. And that is because not all traffic can be held on one of the terminals, on one of the sites. And we estimated that about 10% of the group calls, also in the cranes, will roam to another site than their own site. So a total of 10%, which means that you do not have 100% of traffic, but 110% traffic. But the regulator didn't go for that, and that's a pity. Well, our requirements, 10% group members on both sides, 0.5% probability of queuing, which resulted in 6 carriers for one site and 5 carriers for the second site. But our regulator unfortunately decided different. We got 5 carriers for site number one and 4 carriers for site number two. And on the Euromax terminal, it was even worse. There we had calculated 6 sites, also based on the future, the near future, but the regulator has said that we needed 2 carriers less than that, unfortunately. Back to the transmission trunking. You see the average call duration on the crane team is 5 seconds, which means that if you have an inactivity timer, which is normally 4 seconds or something like that, and that's already rather short, that will mean that you have almost twice as many carriers that you need, because you increase each and every call with 5 seconds. With 4 seconds, the duration of the inactivity timeout. And if you have transmission trunking, there is no inactivity timeout, and then you can use your carriers, your Tetra carriers, much more efficient. And that's exactly what we do. And fortunately, the system we selected, the ROL system, supports transmission trunking. We have called detailed records per call, but and that means that when you have a call, even though it's transmission trunking, when you go up and down and you have a number of conversations in transmission trunking, it will be calculated as one call in the system. Dat meint. Requirement for applications, and that was also a nice one. I think it's the first one in our country, a radio user assignment, where it was initially asked that the radio user assignment should work with the staff number, the personnel number as the run, the radio user number. Maybe you know that in radio user assignment you have two possibilities. You can enter a name or a number. In this case it was a number. And the PIN code was the function, which means that if you're on crane number 25 and you're the man on deck, that your function code will be number 25, crane number 25, man on deck. And that in the dispatchers, that's matched, and the name and the function are matched in the subscriber database when you log in. And that's exactly what you see on the dispatcher if the radio man on deck will transmit on the group. There's also some requirement about AVL and APL, vehicle location and personal location. And it is a challenge, of course, to get the position. Koen already told you that the containers are stacked six high. And if you are between two rows of containers, it will be very difficult to get there. Well, this is the system. Row Hill Tetranode. Two sites on the Delta terminal. One site on the Euromax terminal, and a total of 23 dispatcher consoles. And we are one of the first users of Hytera Chinese subscriber equipment. The Chinese subscriber equipment was selected because it is very robust, and it's not a very light and small terminal. But if you've seen the hands of the harbor guys in Rotterdam, that's about that big, so they can handle the portable radio very well. And it's not a light radio, but it's a robust radio, you can say, and it's IP57 or so. And actually, that doesn't matter that much because they do not have their swimming certificates, and a lot of radios will disappear in the water. So every now and then, they have to dig it up, dig up some radios again. But that will happen. Dispatcher consoles are Rohill Chameleon dispatcher applications. The Rohill made the dispatcher application almost exactly the same as the previous one, as the EDEX one. 60 groups on one terminal with very limited functionality per group, but that's exactly what they need for their operation. They only can see the status, an incoming status, and they can transmit on a group and they can see what happens on the group. One of the specialties is emergency call. Koen already mentioned it. What we're doing is the portable radio or the mobile radio transmits status only. So no emergency call is set up on the system. It's received on the infrastructure, and the dispatcher that accepts that emergency call is the owner of the call. At that point, we will switch over from transmission trunking to message trunking with infinite inactivity timeout and infinite call duration, which means that only the dispatcher that accepts the emergency call is able to terminate the call. And that's what Roel made for us. Thank you very much, Harry. Well, I think that's all. I have 8 seconds left, so let's show this last slide only. Tony,
very
it's
good.
Up to you.
Very good. Excellent timekeeping. Thank you very much. Please join me.